would begin to appreciate the fact that we need God. Even when there are changes in our national affairs, we need God. Help me, Lord Jesus. Can you depend on this God? Can you trust this God? Do you believe that this God has show signs? Do you believe that this God has a favorite? Do you believe that this God has a preferential bias toward whatever? Is all that the prophet says that he is. And he is that and more, then he's able to deal with everything that concerns us. In sicknesses, in crises, in turmoil, in confusion, in chaos, he remains the same. You can take your problems to the Lord and you can leave them there. Someone needs to tell the alcoholic that. Someone needs to tell the one who's abusing drugs and habits. When they are of meager means or meager means, they love God and they talk about God. They always have God on their lips. Then their fortune changes. They start to have a bit of status. Can I preach? They start to have a bit of money. They can take care of themselves. And so God, who used to be the preeminent one in their lives, God now is relegated to the back seat. Perhaps not even the back seat, not even in the vehicle. But you will need God at some point in your life. Hallelujah. Your money can only go so far. Your status in life can only go so far. Whatever people say about you, whether good, whether better, whether can only resonate for so long. Ultimately, we need to be reconciled to the fact that we need a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. This God heals. He heals when he calls his children home. I watched this morning, Anna, you were having difficulty saying goodbye to your mother as they were trying to close the coffin. But God called mommy home. God called mommy home. Mommy is now enjoying this robe of flesh, and all of us will embrace what God has provided for us. High blood pressure, sugar diabetes, insomnia, bad condition, having to deal with disgusting family members one of these days, so help me Lord. Having to work so hard for children who will turn their backs on you in a heartbeat one of these days. This will all fall away. People may take advantage of you. But he also allows his children to undergo difficulties from time to time. Why he does this, I do not always know. But I'm comforted that even when this is happening, he is still the Lord my shepherd. You may be sitting in this place today with very little or next to no money in your pocket or in your wallet. But God will take care of you. Thank you. That's a comforting assurance. I do not know why sometimes good people, so-called, must go through the problems that they go through. Why people who live outside of God, I do not know why it seems as if they always seem to get by. But I know that if we trust God, and if we continue to serve God, after a while God will come and God will himself. I thank God for the faithfulness of God. As I'm driving about Bishop Kendall sometimes, I see the drunkard on the side of the street. He gets wet in the rain. He doesn't get sick. He drives off. He eats out of the garbage. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. Is anyone here with me today? He drinks water wherever he can find it from. And I've seen the righteous Bishop Thompson. If you sit under the air condition too long, you start to stiffle. And sometimes I wonder why things are the way they are. But I want to tell us in this place today, remain faithful and serve God in the name of Jesus. Don't let your circumstances or your situation determine how you will serve God. Just keep serving Him. Who don't want to speak to you? That's on them. Keep serving God. Who want to talk badly about you? That too is on them. You just keep praising God. Hallelujah. Sometimes you may not be able to make sense to people, but just sing a song or quote a scripture and find comfort in the word of God. I thank God for the promises of a better life after this life. Hallelujah. The Bible tells us that He is our shepherd. And I'm strengthened because even when Satan appears to be winning, His word tells me that I am more than a conqueror through Him that loves us. Romans 8:37. Life is more than the comfort which many have been deceived into believing. You know, we are thingified. We love things. We love things. We put pressure. Sometimes wives put pressure on their husband to buy stuff. Poor man gets sick. Can I speak to a Bahamian church? The poor man gets sick trying to supply the needs for his wife. Oh, help me, Lord. Every time she wants something. Now this goes the other way too. Please, so stay with me. Okay? But he works hard trying to make ends meet for her, and she seems never to be able to get enough. Some of you wives are married to men that are more cranky than their mothers. Oh, help me, Lord. They complain about everything. The food too hot, the food too cold, the food too much, the food too little. Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. But at the end, I'm sure you remain faithful. Go back home to your little rowdy wife. Go back home to your grouchy husband. Sit down and won't eat, won't do a thing, and ask him to give him everything. Bring the food. Do this, do that. And all you do, you're trying to stay safe. Help me, Holy Ghost. You're trying to stay safe, you're trying to stay filled with the Holy Ghost, but you want to just bust loose and tell him something. But you remain faithful unto God. You remain faithful unto God. God wants us to be faithful to Him. Sometimes the problems come where you work. Your boss is terrible. Your supervisor is worse. Oh, help me, Lord. Am I speaking to anyone in this place today? They push you and they grind you to powder, and they want you to continue to do more and more as they give you less and less. But continue to serve God. Some of you, as I said, you have children, and they're the most ungrateful children you ever want. You give them everything, but they still don't want to come back down the other side of the road. But you better keep serving God. Help me, Holy Ghost. You go to church, and someone don't want to speak to you. It seems as if the pastor is taking his text on you, but still serve God. Some of you are still vexed because the PMP lost the election, but still serve God in the name of Jesus. Some of you are looking for special favors because the FLM won the election. I tell you, you better serve God in the name of Jesus. Some of you, you're getting old in age, and you're still playing young and showing off like you're young, but you better serve God. Some of you competing with your young girls and your young sons, but in the name of Jesus, this preacher tells you, serve! Look at someone as a substance. There's so many fakers around. You may even be sitting next to a faker. But God washes the servant in spirit and in truth. And he's going to be servant in spirit and in truth. We can expect a larger life. Hallelujah. So life ultimately is about what we do with God. I'm trying to close it. You see, when it is all said and done, we must still be confronted by what we did with the question of our eternal destiny. You will need him for everything else in this life. But if you don't have him at the end of this existence as we know it, then you are eternally lost. And if God is everything, and if we don't have him, then we are nothing. We need him to be something. You know, I've traveled around this country. I've traveled extensively outside this country. Sometimes you walk by people, and as you walk by them, you could feel yourself getting small. And small and small, because they're so big, and they're so pompous, and they're so filled with themselves. You might be sitting next to one of them right now. Can I preach to this church as I get ready to take my seat? But I have a word for you. You have been deceived if you believe that your status in life can get you by. Hallelujah. You've been deceived badly if you think that the good deeds you do for others will amount to anything before a righteous God who is unimpressed by our works of righteousness. You've been deceived if you think your humanitarian efforts will get you through. You've been deceived if your member in a church is your passport out of this world. You've been badly tricked if you think that God's word does not mean what it says. What does it say in Romans 6:23? For the wages of sin is death. Gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Some people get offended at this kind of preaching, Mr. Thompson. People want to hear about a new car. People want to hear about driving on the ridge. People want to hear that your no good husband can die while you're cracking. But scripture is telling us that God places the emphasis for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let's stop having church and start having a relationship with God. Hallelujah. Tomorrow morning, many people will be having church. Today, a Sabbath. Many people are having church, but far too few have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Oh, it'll be so good if tomorrow you can talk about your relationship with God. Hallelujah. Give him a clap of praise. Some people are sitting down with a checklist and waiting for you to fail so they can just say, see, I told you so. His word is not misleading, nor is it contradictory. His word tells us exactly what is in his heart, what is in the heart of his loving Savior. Here's what he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Upon you and learn of me, for I am meek, this is Jesus, and lowly at heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. Matthew 11:28-29. A long time ago, let me tell you Sister Joanna's testimony. A long time ago, Joanna Miller was confronted with this question, what do I do with God? Joanna Miller chose to accept Jesus as a Savior of the Lord. All of the nice accolades that we poured on her, and thank God for it, will amount to nothing if we cannot say that there was a time in her life that she surrendered everything to the Lord Jesus Christ. Things were not perfect. I'm still giving her testimony. Things were not perfect. But she took God and his word. There were days, still talking about her testimony, there were days, Anna Marie, hallelujah, when perhaps she thought that she had bitten off more than she could chew. But Joanna bit off so little. So 69 years, so little. You ought to be encouraged. If you're 30, you ought to be encouraged. If you're 58 like me, you ought to be encouraged. Ought to be encouraged. I went to visit my father, 97 years old. Very, very fluid. And if you heard the way he talked about God, he's 97 and 58. So her testimony, she's so good. So when you have your challenges, that's true. Do you remember mommy's testimony in this house today? She's so good. This company of witnesses that are here today, or is here today, I want you to know too that you can so good. So, although her husband by the middle, the children, other family members, friends in the wider community are pained by this loss. They all recognize she's absent from this keyboard. And she's with them. Would you stand on this? What we go through down here will one day give way to a better life in the hereafter. My word of encouragement to the seniors among us, the older people of here today. Your days and years of pain, your years of concern and loneliness. Sometimes when you get old, you get very lonely. I visit a lot of old people. One of the biggest hurdles that they have to deal with is loneliness. Another thing that old people have to deal with, or older persons have to deal with, is memory. Memory. Remembering and recalling so many things that perhaps you wish you could have done differently, or even things that brought you joy but have now escaped you. But hold on. All of the challenges, they need not defeat you. You cannot be assured that you too can have. Before we pray generally, I want to specifically ask anyone in this place today. You do not know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior. Would you walk these aisles? These same aisles that many have walked. These aisles that Joanna Miller herself walked. Pray and to praise her God, to give of her substance. I'm going to ask you to walk these aisles as an indication that you want to receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior and as your Lord. I'm not calling you to the jumper church. I'm not calling you to dogma or philosophy. I'm inviting you to be reconciled with God. Scripture says he's given us, people like me, those who proclaim Jesus Christ, the ministry of reconciliation. As the Bible, he's made us ambassadors. So I stand here as his ambassador, and I beckon to you to come. Come. I make another appeal to a second group of persons. You're in this place today, and your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ has been broken. You're in a state of estrangement. You don't speak to him anymore. You feel the nudging and the convicting power of the Holy Spirit, but for whatever reason, you push it off and you push it off and you've been pushing it off, and perhaps even now you may be stingy. But if you're in a bastard condition, I call you in the name of Jesus Christ and in the spirit that we feel in this place today to come, and let's make this coffin an altar. Would you come? Then I make a third appeal, those persons in this group, you don't even have to come. But this group, you just want to be strengthened because the things in life have just been battering and battering and battering. Discouraged, frustration. So many other vices of life have been coming at you incessantly. But I want to call you to a place of prayer. If you're that person, if you're any of those persons, raise your hand in the name of Jesus. I see you, keep your hand. I see you, sir. I see you, ma'am. I see you with both hands up. I see you. Bow your head. Hallelujah. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ, we believe, Lord, that we have faithfully discharged your word in this place, O God. We believe, Lord, that this day, Lord, will be a witness either for or against those who sat in this place. Father, we invoke your presence, Lord, in an intimate way in the lives of every person in this tabernacle. You know, Lord, those who are broken by the situations and challenges in life, touch them in the name of Jesus. Free them, O God. Those who have been calling on your name and serving you faithfully, Lord. But it seems as if the relentless attacks of the enemy is unabated. Touch them, Lord. Give them strength to carry on. We thank you, Lord, that some man, some woman, some boy or girl who may not have stood in this place, Lord, but in the recesses of their heart have accepted Jesus Christ as Savior, truly transformed them in the name of Jesus. Your word tells us that all things are passed away and all things are becoming keep your people. And Father, we pray for this community called the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Touch this nation. We need you, Lord. We need you more than we need plans. We need you more than we need strategies, oh God, or even the implementations. We need you, Lord, to be in our heart. We need you to be the center of our affection. Keep us, oh God. And help us, Lord, as we leave this place today, that we will take this message nestled in our hearts. We will take it into our communities, and we will endeavor to invite everyone and anyone to come to know your Son, Jesus Christ, the Savior, whom to know is life eternal. We thank you again, Father. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the blessed Holy Spirit, and God's people said, oh, to Jesus.
such a wonderful and powerful eulogy and sermon to us here today. And it behooves all of us to hear. The Bible says we must take more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we let them slip. As inasmuch as you may forget it, God's not going to forget that He told you. So you can't afford to let things slip. So if He's speaking to your heart, you ought to respond. You ought to respond in a positive manner. Amen? Amen. We're calling now on Pastor Kino McCartney, the Christ Community Church, who will come now and pray for the family.
In our church. Bless the Lord for the word that was presented. Bishop Hanna, Moderator, Bishop Simmons. Let's bow in a word of prayer. The Lord has given us the comfort that He said that He is going to prepare a place for us, that where He is going, we don't have to worry about anything. For He said, in my Father's house there are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, and I go to prepare a place for you. And there, Sister Joanna is in a better place. Bring condolences on behalf of our Bishop, Dr. Deanza Cunningham, his dear wife, Edris Cunningham, fine family of Christ Community Church, pastors and members, and also the care group of Mark. Let's bow. Precious God and Heavenly Father, we come to You today. No other name than the name of Your Son, Jesus the Christ, who has already given us the assurance that He has already defeated hell, death, and the grave. Thank You for the victory that He has given us of eternal life. God, we present this family, the Miller family, to You. We present first the loving husband. Oh, God, Brother Willard Miller Sr. God, a husband for 49 years. You loaned this precious jewel to this man. God, continue to strengthen him, undergird him, God, even as he faces the day. Children, Anna Marie, husband Ted, Raquel, a husband Kent, William Jr., Anna, his wife Kenya. Oh God, I pray that You will surround this family with Your grace and Your mercy. Father, even as their parents has left a legacy of love and life, may they also show forth this same love in their family life. Oh God. the loving balm of Gilead. Surround him now. These things we ask in no other name than our conquering King, our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, who shall return.
Our service here at the church, and we will continue at the graveside at the Lakeview Cemetery. Please be reminded that there will be a procession by the Bahama Brass Band beginning from what we call the Lutheran Church on John F. Kennedy Drive. It will be parading from that spot onto the cemetery, and we invite you to come and march along with us as we go with rejoicing to deposit the remains of our dear sister. God bless you today. Please remain standing as we do, as the band takes us away with our recessional.